great service plan for you guys. Let's take two. All right, we need one of those things. We have a great service plan for you guys.
Let's worship together with Jacob.
Hey, 707. Good to see you guys again. This is Mason. He's joining me. Sam joined me last week, and Mason's here with us this week. So I'm gonna bring a new musician every week. Just kidding. Well, maybe. I don't know. I'm trying to mix it up. I don't want to make false promises, but it's really cool to have Mason with us playing bass. So let's get some worship going, and let's just sing. I love this song. Man, what a timely... This song is always a timely song. Just to say that he's good even when we don't think he is, when things aren't going swimmingly. So, all right, here we go. And let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. And you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good. The king of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anger in the waves. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. Be the wind. Let the king inside my sails, the anger in the waves. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. 'Cause you are good, you're good.
Good, you're good.
worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus. Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you.
Holy.
Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Worthy.
Worthy of every song. Of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Yeah, we do. Yeah, we do.
Jesus, the name above all names.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. You are holy, holy. There is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are. Beside you, open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will build my life and your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. God, I just say thank you for these lyrics today to remind even myself that the ground that you provide us is not sinking sands, it's our cornerstone. We can find exactly what we need in you. There's no one who loves us the way that you do, God. It seems like there's so many other things to run to, so many idols we can look to, but Lord, through this song and through these lyrics, we confess that yours is the kingdom, yours is the firm foundation, and we sing these songs straight to your heart today. You have a purpose and you have a plan behind everything you do. It can be hard to see sometimes, but God, we believe that now. And if not, help us believe. Crush our unbelief today. We want to trust you more and we want to know you more. We love you, we worship you, we pray all these things in your name. Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
What's up, 707? It's Adam, and I'm coming at you from the Student Center, and I can't wait until we're here again, celebrating and worshiping together and hearing God's word together in person. It's going to be a great day. It's going to be a great day. Hey, as we dive in today, I want to challenge us in a few areas. First, I hope that you listened to this past weekend's message on Oak Point's website. Pastor Bob shared his heart. He was a bit angry. He was full of righteous anger, and he challenged us as a church to the core. And if you have not watched that message, I would challenge you even today before you go to bed, but to pull it up, watch Bob's message. He has a conversation with Sonny, a pastor in Detroit, a black man, and Sonny shares some insightful yet challenging things. And I just so appreciate Bob's heart when it comes to this topic especially, and especially just the stance that he's taking, the righteous anger stance. And in your life groups, you're gonna actually talk about the difference between righteous anger and just regular anger, and the benefits of righteous anger and what it could do. You learned this in history class, but the civil rights movement, it was born out of righteous anger. And I feel like we're in the midst of something that could be birthed out of a righteous anger. And I think this past weekend's message from Pastor Bob is just the beginning of it. And so definitely take a listen. And when you listen, I think our posture should be one of a couple things, because I think it'd be really difficult to hear the words Bob has to say. And so the first thing I think we need to put on is humility. We need to put on the posture of humility. We don't know everything. We don't have all the answers. And yet we're talking to people who could help us. We're talking to black leaders in our community that have been dealing with this issue of bias and racism way longer than we have. And so we're going to talk about that, and we're going to hear conversations, and we need to put on humility as we hear them. Because once we think we know the answer, pride begins to well up, and it's then that learning stops. And so we need to approach it with humility as we listen to these conversations. The second posture I would encourage you to take is a posture of listening. And I don't mean just listening in general, because a lot of people listen to share opinions. A lot of people listen so that they could strike back with their own thoughts. I would love for our community to be a community of people who listen to understand. That when someone is done talking and we're listening, we don't just immediately respond, we actually digest what they just said. And if we have any follow-up questions, we'll ask those, because we have nothing to say. We're just here to listen. That's the posture that I would love for us to take, one of humility, and one of simply listening to understand. Friends, I think we all know this, but we need to acknowledge that racism and racial bias At the heart of that is sin. And the only solution to sin is Jesus. And we as a church have not lost our mission to know Jesus and to make him known. We do that in a lot of ways, but that is our goal. And we can still accomplish that goal. I feel like we are even more closer to accomplishing that goal now more than ever as we engage topics that are way more difficult to wrap our arms around, especially when we do that with love and grace and kindness and a listening ear. And so may we, as we engage this conversation, may we have humility and may we listen to understand. And you'll talk about that in a little bit in your life groups. Especially the righteous anger piece. I'm excited for you guys to talk about that. But this whole topic leads to our topic today. And again, this won't be super long. I'd really love for the rest of our life group time, the rest of our 707 times, especially in the month of June, to be focused on relational hangout. A lot of you are watching this with your life group, and I think that's fantastic. We're allowed to do that now. And I think we need to take advantage of that. So I'm just gonna offer a couple thoughts and then you'll be free to discuss. And if you're not hanging out in your life groups, I pray that you'll get on Zoom again and you'll engage with your life group that way. You'll connect no matter what form you use to connect, you'll still connect with your life group. But today I just want to bring up the topic of cultural discernment. And how do we engage with our culture when we may not know what to say or we don't know what to do or so many venues of information are coming our way. We don't know who to believe, what's true, what's not true. What do we do with our culture? How do we engage what's happening in our country, in our world that's helpful? How do we gauge it in a way that's helpful? So I want to talk about that because the temptation and the danger is to simply educate yourself with a Google search. And the first three articles pop up and you're clicking on them because they probably paid the most money to get to the top of the search. And that's where you're getting your information, and maybe potentially that's where you're getting your bias. And who knows? Who knows, who wrote those articles? Who knows if it's true? The danger is opinions can be formed, which informs our actions, which informs our behaviors. And if we're not anchored in something, if we're not anchored in something larger than our culture or larger than this world or our country, we could be swayed in different directions. And so I wanna just give you two practical things as so much is happening in our culture and so many venues of information come our way. I wanna encourage you in two ways. One, the first tip is we need to be anchored in Scripture. That's the first. The Scriptures are our playbook. The Scriptures are our way to handle a culture that's ever changing. God is not changing. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he has given us his Scriptures to express who he is and his love towards us. And yet our Scripture is the playbook. And even though in a changing culture, things will come at us in different ways and things will change, we have a playbook. We have an anchor that we can go back to. That this anchor, these scriptures should be the lens through which we look at the world. So many people throughout Scripture have done this. They have looked at their culture. They have looked at the shifting landscape and they have viewed it through the lens of what God says, what Scripture says. The Old Testament is full of them. Joseph is an example of someone who looked at the shifting landscape and yet was anchored in God, anchored in the Scriptures. Jeremiah was a prophet that looked at the coming exile for the Israelites, and he predicted it. He told them it was coming, and yet he gave them tips on how to discern the culture. He gave them tips on how to thrive in a different culture of their own. And it was rooted in being anchored in God. Daniel was another one. Daniel and his buddies were presented with exile, presented with taking themselves out of their own country, being exiled to another country with all their culture differences and all the things that the king wanted to thrust upon them because that was normal for that culture. And yet they stayed true with what God wanted them to do, with how God wanted them to live. And the common denominator, they were anchored in Scripture. We see Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We see Esther and Mordecai. We see Peter in 1 Peter chapter 4, I believe, calls us as believers foreigners and sojourners, which basically we're exiles. We are not of this world. We are kingdom citizens. We are living for the kingdom. And it's a beautiful, beautiful thing because we can now, as citizens of God's kingdom, we can play by his rules. We can play by his playbook. Now, we don't have to conform to our culture, Romans tells us, but we can be transformed by the renewing of our minds, which is anchored in Scripture. See, we need to be anchored in Scripture. John, while he was in exile in the Isle of Patmos, John wrote down essentially what Revelation is. And in that, he called people to be exiles. He called people to live differently in their culture, to not be so in tune to their culture that they forget that they're a part of the kingdom of God. And so in our shifting culture, we need to be anchored in the Scriptures. We need to have the Bible as our playbook, and we need to be diving into it every single day. That way we know how to respond. That way we know what it is God would have us do. The second thing we need to do is we need to stay informed. We need to stay informed in our culture. We need to know what's going on. We need to engage. We need to know how to view things through the lens of Scripture, but we need to have things to view through the lens of Scripture. We need to know what's going on. Now, what I'm not saying is to immerse yourself so much to the point where you forget Scripture. Because remember, Scripture is our anchor. And I heard a quote once that from a Christian theologian that says, you should have a newspaper in one hand and a Bible in the other. Now, obviously that was before the internet or social media, but I feel like you should have your iPhone in one hand and the Bible in the other. So as you get your news, wherever you get it from, you are seeing it through the lens of Scripture. But we want you to stay informed. We think it's important for you to know what's going on. Because burying your head in the sand and pretending like nothing's happening or pretending that it doesn't affect you, that's just a not helpful way to go about living life. We need to be engaged to a point where we know what's going on and we are searching for how Jesus would respond to it. So we're searching the Scriptures. We are getting to know the God who wrote these Scriptures for us through his people. We are getting to know his heart through the Scriptures. And so that we can respond to things like the past couple weeks, and we can respond to it in love and kindness. And see, the danger would be to polarize it the last couple weeks, the protests and the riots and the killings, and to polarize it between left or right or make it political. And it's dangerous because it's leaving out the humanity of it. When we see it through the lens of Scripture, we see it very clearly that it's a kingdom of God issue. And people who bear God's image are being harmed. And we can do something about it. See, when we see it through the lens of Scripture, it no longer belongs to a party, but it belongs to the kingdom we belong to, the citizens of God, the kingdom of God. And so as we engage culture, we must view the events through the lens of Scripture. Whether you watch this channel for news or this channel for news, or whether you surf this site or whatever, wherever you get your news, that's not your playbook. Our playbook is the Bible, the Scriptures, and God has showed us what we should do. First Peter calls us foreigners, like I said, exiles. We are not living for this kingdom here that we see in our culture. We are living for a kingdom not of this world. We are citizens of the kingdom of God. 1 Thessalonians 5, in it, we are told to test everything and hold to what is true. What does that mean? But to look at everything our culture has to offer and test it and to say, okay, here's what Scripture says. Here's the truth. How does that line up with that? Here's what my news media outlet is telling me in regards to a certain people group. Does that line up with Scripture? And then lastly, 1 John 4 tells us again to test the spirits. There are spirits of this world that would lead us down destructive paths, and we are to test them. We are to look at them and say, okay, is this true? And the bar that we hold them to is Scripture. We need to test them according to God's truth. And so those are my two helpful things as we engage our culture. We need to, one, anchor in Scripture, know that that is our playbook, nothing else. And we need to actually engage. We need to stay informed. We need to know what's going on. And we need to be helpful. And so remember, as we go to life groups, we are not citizens of this world. We're citizens of the kingdom of God. We did that whole series, Kingdom Life, before quarantine even hit. And it's never more true now that we get our playbook from the scriptures. We live for a different king. His name is Jesus. He calls our shots. He is the one who is guiding our lives. And may that be true of all of us who call 707 home. May it be true of you that you're choosing to live as a citizen of this kingdom, as a citizen of God's kingdom, that scripture is your playbook. You're engaged in culture in a very helpful, loving, kind, and grace-filled way. And just like Pastor Bob said in this past weekend's message, there is a time for righteous anger. And may we use that appropriately. May we get righteously angry when people who bear the image of God are not treated like they bear the image of God. Friends, again, like I said in the beginning, I cannot wait till this room is full again with you all. Until that day, stay connected and stay on our social media, stay on our emails. We will update you when we are going to have some test services and get back to what we refer to as normal. So, hey, friends, thanks again for tuning in. I hope you have some good life group discussion on what it means to engage culture through the lens of scripture. And I really hope you talk about this past weekend's message as well. Talk to you guys later.
I'm so excited to be back with everyone worshiping as one whole group.
I'm so excited to see everyone we haven't seen in so long.
I'm finally excited to dab people up and just be able to high five my friends.
I'm excited to get back together and worship again, even though it's already been said.
I'm excited for live music again.
I'm excited for the community that we have.
I'm excited to see all the girls in my small group again.
I'm excited to worship together again.
I'm excited to worship around people again.
And I'm excited to finally see this one in person.
I'm excited to see everyone.
Yeah, I am so pumped to be back together and see everybody again.
I'm really excited to see everyone again and worship together.
And I'm honestly excited to just hang out in the atrium and just talk to y'all.
Thanks for coming next week. Woo!